Maximum. Maximum magnification.
Maximum mag.
More.
Don't stop at things you don't understand.
Did you expect to find anything suspicious? It is easy enough to clear this up.
Standard intelligence service procedure.
Concentrate once again. This time we may learn something.
Hey, what's up, guys? Welcome to part two. We go over why we're actually replacing this. Here's a little hint. We have a broken turbine wheel. So just in case you're kind of new to turbochargers, I wanted to go through some of the basic components on this unit off of our 2017 EXT. Now found here is the electronic actuator. It has a motor and sensor, obviously, that pushes this rod in and out. This rod is connected to this wastegate arm down here, and the wastegate controls any excess exhaust to be bypassed past the turbine so it won't spin it up too fast. That'll allow you to control boost. Now in the past, this was done with a diaphragm that was acted on with a boost pressure from your intake manifold or actually your charge piping. But in this case, it's all electronic, so really the sky's the limit as far as boost control. You could have a lot of different, you know, parameters built in depending on the tuning. Now the other part is gonna be this housing, this aluminum piece up here. That's gonna be the compressor housing. Back here we have the turbine housing. Now one thing to know is Honda used a lot of different materials in this turbocharger unit. It is built by Mitsubishi Heavy Industries. It's a TD03 style turbo, and they use somewhat of a stainless steel housing here. That'll help control heat from being kind of expelled out into the engine bay. Same thing with a lot of the other components, such as the arm, the here for the wastegate. A few other pieces are stainless, and obviously the turbine itself. A lot of the time, some manufacturers use it like Inconel or something. Not 100% sure what it is. We haven't, you know, really looked into the materials of it. I don't think anybody's done research on that. But yeah, those are some of the basics. In here, you're gonna have your inlet air coming in and then your outlet air coming out. The turbine gets its exhaust gases from up here, and they go ahead and spin the turbine wheel and they come out the downpipe end here. This is where your catalytic converter is bolted onto. But yeah, you can see here, the magnet I have is not really sticking to any of these components. It does stick to this stuff here a little bit, but it sticks really well to the hardware. You can see how well it sticks to that. It sticks a little bit to some of these pieces. So that just tells us that they used stainless steel or high nickel content, basically some exotic materials to try to, you know, keep heat inside the turbo and out the exhaust passageway, as opposed to letting it radiate out into the engine bay. So you might be wondering, this turbo looks perfectly fine. What's wrong with it? Inside of here, like I mentioned earlier, it has a compressor wheel, turbine wheel. They're connected through a main shaft. Usually that shaft is part of the turbine wheel itself, and then the compressor wheel is bolted onto that. This turbine wheel should be able to spin, but instead it kind of just wiggles around. It's not, I mean, yeah, it could get it to spin, kind of jams up. So what happened is the bearings are basically seized up. The turbine shaft broke, because now I could actually spin the compressor wheel and turbine wheel independent of one another. I could spin the compressor wheel and hold the turbine wheel in place. So that's not good. And one of the things, you know, I kind of noticed at the track was that it started howling and whistling under load. It was kind of a giveaway in that I suspected something to be wrong with some kind of air passageway. I was hoping it would be an intake manifold leak. Turned out that it wasn't. Once I was on the highway, I saw a puff of smoke after the howling got worse and worse, and actually it ended up going away. But I saw a puff of smoke, which is basically probably the oil seals giving out, seizing up, something to that extent. And just to show you guys here, this is gonna be our new turbocharger. And you can see it spins pretty smoothly without any real resistance. Same thing on the front. Again, the compressor wheel is connected to the turbine, so I could spin this pretty easily and I could reach it from the back here. Let's go ahead and continue with the teardown, take off all of this piping and clamps and all this. That way we can gain access to the components that failed, see how they failed, if there's any marking, scoring, signs of overheating. And just to give you guys a good view of the wastegate, here's the wastegate valve, and you can see how it opens up. Now that's connected directly to the passageway that has incoming exhaust gases, and instead of coming out of the turbine wheel, spinning up the turbo even faster, you could control boost by bypassing that exhaust gas through here. Now it's hard to tell, but this turbine, it is scratched up here along the fins, and oh, was not expecting that. So you can see where it actually broke off. The shaft is right in there. This is supposed to be connected to that piece. But also you can see that it looks like some of the oil got accumulated here just from it blowing out the seals and overheating. So yeah, here's the turbine wheel. This is supposed to be attached to the shaft inside there. You have your backing plate for the turbine itself. You can see it's actually very dirty, very oily. I don't think it's necessarily supposed to be like that from my experience. They do have a layer of carbon, but this one has more of a oily kind of, viscosity to it, I guess you could say. You can also see some oil residue here. That might be kind of normal. You do see some on the kind of the innards, but not necessarily on the outer part. So let's go ahead and clean this up a bit just so I don't get my hands dirty anymore. And we'll take off the compressor housing as well.
I'm ready if you are.
One quick thing before I take off the compressor housing. It's pretty cool. Mitsubishi Heavy Industries or Honda. I'm not sure exactly who designed this unit, but they have an alignment pin here. Makes it really easy in the future if you ever are going to go this far into upgrading your turbocharger, maybe getting a bigger wheel, what have you. They have an alignment pin. Pretty neat feature. You don't see that too often, at least as far as I know. One thing here is you can see the oil seal. That's one of them. I think it should have two. You can see here there's a second groove there that's empty. So I'm not sure if it's supposed to have two seals, but in either case, that kind of goes in there, seals any oil from leaking out through the back. Turn Turns out we needed some bigger snap ring pliers, so I had to go down to the store, but yeah, let's go ahead and take this off here. These can be a little bit tricky, pretty tough. Notice the orientation of this, it has like a chamfered edge here. You want that facing up. Same deal, they have an alignment hole or pin, sort of. So here we have the compressor housing. You can see it's been scored a little bit. Yeah, definitely feel a few gouges here on this aluminum, and there's some heavy oil and probably aluminum dust on here. Mark this up pretty good. Other than that though, it looks okay. There is some sealant here. Obviously you don't want any boost leak coming out through the back here, but nothing too bad, fortunately. I think this might be salvageable for an upgrade that we would want to do in the future. And then we have the compressor or CHRA, the center housing rotating assembly. Compressor wheel. Now this is not supposed to happen like this, I believe. Oh, no, it won't come out. But it's not supposed to have this much play. One of the journal bearings fell out here. It's on the back. Usually these will have two journal bearings. Ball bearing turbos are obviously a lot better in regards that it'll spool up faster and give it a better boost response. But for the size of this turbo, I wouldn't be surprised if the advantages are almost negligible. Once you get into a bigger turbo wheel, compressor wheel and such, then yeah, you definitely will see some advantages. You can see how much oil there was on here. It's not normal by any standards. Some oil is okay, but not in the excessive amount that this has. But I'm gonna try to see. No, there's no way. I'm gonna try to see if I could take this nut off in order to take off the compressor wheel. As you can see, the compressor wheel blades are scored just from, again, rubbing on the compressor housing. One thing to know is you want to go in the opposite, or actually I believe the same direction as the blades. I felt the nut move, but I think it's actually tightening, so this one might be a reverse thread or left hand thread. Let's see. Yeah. So there we have the compressor wheel, a lot of oil on here, not necessarily normal for this. You can see some scoring or marking on there. And I'm not an expert on Mitsubishi turbos or MHI turbos, but I believe this is what they call a superback. It has kind of like a concave or dish shape to it, as opposed to just being straight flat. So I might be able to source a repair kit for this pretty easily. We'll probably end up measuring some of the components here. Just take off the turbine shaft. Now, just to show you guys, that is supposed to be one piece with this. So somehow through overheating, or actually, you know, we were running the turbo pretty hard. We were running very high boost levels, just to find the limits of these components. And it could also be just, you know, kind of the torsional forces on this. You know, we're trying to boost high boost levels. Obviously, you know, the shear force was excessive and it ended up tearing the shaft for us. Some kind of metal fragments in here, it seems. I'm not too sure. You can see a lot of heavy scoring here from this guessing a thrust spacer writing on there. That probably happened due to the fact that the turbine shaft fell apart. But again, my name is Rudy from Pro Car Studio. Definitely let us know if you have any questions or comments down below. Make sure to check out our website, www.procivic.com. Give us a call or send us an email again if you have any questions, and as always, I'll see you next time.